You are now locked in and listening to The Issue.
This guy is a franchise quarterback, and no, I don't want to hear any pushback on that.
It feels like a top 10 roster to me. It feels like it can win a championship.
This is The Issue.
Yo, what's up? We are back. It is The Issue. It is Thursday, February 16th. Fantastic show coming up for you today. So we have the Super Bowl to review, right? America's biggest holiday, the NFL's Super Bowl 57 was a fantastic watch. We have all of
it was an all-timer. It's an all-timer.
Easily. Great 100%. Matchup. Lots to talk about from that today. We're gonna piss off a couple, at least one fan base today.
If you've seen my attire already, you already are pissed, I would imagine.
Yeah. If you're from a particular part of Pennsylvania, Philly.
If you're from the dirtiest city on the East Coast, welcome. We appreciate you stopping in. Hey, I have some complimentary things to say about the Eagles here in a little bit.
They played well on offense.
I'm just going to throw it out there.
Yeah.
I do have some complimentary things to say about the Eagles, but we'll get there when we get there. Yeah. I'm also going to piss them off, too. It's a balance.
You have to keep a balance.
And hey, I do the same thing with their rival, the Cowboys. I'm telling you, Dak's a franchise guy. But he's not worth $45 million.
No.
So it's a balancing act. It's all balancing.
But the show today is going to be great. So we have the opening rant from Tim to start off. I have it titled as Philly, Hold Your L. So that's kind of the gist of things. And then we're going to move into hits and misses to finish off the first segment like we normally do. And then in the second segment, we are re-ranking the top 10 players from the Super Bowl. We did a pre-ranking before the Super Bowl. We're going to go over where we were right, wrong, kind of like a second hits and misses, except a little more specific.
Yeah.
There's
a couple. We're going to hold a couple L's on that one. I'm just going to throw it out.
Yeah.
Jalen not being on the list, that one's going to hurt a little bit.
That does hurt.
We're going to talk about that.
Finish out that segment with the news, though, and then in the third, we will have a kind of another rant discussion to get to, and then we will play Up, Down, Sideways. Haven't broken that game out in a while.
It's been a while.
Mainly because we've just been so swamped with predictions for the last 28 weeks.
Just something like that, right?
So we will do an Up, Down, Sideways on how NFL teams stand currently, what their outlook's like, and we'll get into all that. But that's the show for today, so let's hop right in. Philly loses.
So I'm gonna start off relatively complimentary to Philly. I would say, you know, I'm not a Chiefs fan. I'm a Pittsburgh guy. So I'm not going to sit there and act like I'm rooting for Philly I'm impartial. No, I'm not. I don't like Philly. Let's be real here. And I've been pretty honest about that, right? I mean, but I will say I have great respect for Jalen Hurts. I would pay him tomorrow. I think the maturity, the leadership, what he showed with a bad shoulder. I thought for 15-minute quarter, so 45. I would say for about 53 minutes, he thoroughly outplayed Patrick Mahomes. I would say if you made a list of the top five throws, he had four of them. I mean, that throw to Goddard, insane. There were a couple of them, right? So he had a fantastic game. And here's what's crazy. Did you see the Hail Mary at the end? If that doesn't tell you what Jalen was playing through, he made it like, 35 yards? It was an awful throw. Because that shows you what he was playing with that shoulder. He was nowhere close to 100%. Put on an all-time performance. Nick Sirianni, I would say, really nice game plan. Did you get beat in the adjustment game? Yeah. Who'd you get beat by? Andy Reid. I mean, are we going to sit here? Are we going to crucify Nick Sirianni? Because he didn't make as good of adjustments as, the best coach, especially the best second-half coach, especially the best second-half coach off a bye in league history? No.
With the best quarterback.
No, with the best quarterback, right? Like, that's just the. I'm not going to sit there and crucify Nick Sirianni for that. We can nitpick this, that, and the other thing. But in reality, he had a really nice game plan, was really, really emotional, was fired up. His team fed off it. You could feel it early, right? So now that I said that about the Eagles, I just want to preface it by saying that. Much like my message to Cincinnati, shut your mouth, all right? I am so sick and tired. But the call. Oh, the holding call. Okay, let's break this down. First of all, everybody on the internet that's taking a little screenshot of the call, can we actually screenshot the correct portion of the play that the actual penalty was on? It wasn't when Juju turned upfield. Not at all. It was when he was making the break to then break back outside and burn Bradbury like they've burned the DBs on like five or six routes in the same very quarter. Okay? So That's where the holding was. Let's start there. Second of all, if I hear one more person tell me that that ball was uncatchable, I'm going to lose my effing mind. Clearly, you don't know football. If I get one little weasel from Philadelphia in my TikTok comment telling me that I suck and that this is the worst take and that that ball was uncatchable, I will literally jump through the screen at your 8-year-old face and punt you down the stairs, kid. Because you clearly don't know football. Obviously. Because if you did, you'd know that there's no such thing as an uncatchable football on a holding call. You want to know why? And I bet you don't even know why. Because if you're dumb enough to make that argument, you don't know why. I'll tell you why. Because a holding penalty is contact or impedance of the receiver before the ball is thrown. So the ball is not in the air when the penalty is committed. Therefore, the ball that has not been thrown yet cannot be uncatchable because it's still in the freaking quarterback's hand. Okay, let's start there. Third thing. The whole, at that stage of the game, you can't make that call in that moment. What are you talking about? It's the same rules the entire game. Whenever they first snap the ball, the first play of the game and the last play of the game, it's the same rule book. I hate to tell you. There's not a breakdown by like, hey, first quarter, this is what you're going to call. Second quarter, you're going to call this. Like, I know the whole, like, scripted thing has been big. Like, there's not, like, a script for what the officials call based on the quarter. I hate to let you in on that information, Philly fans. I'm sorry to bum you out, but that's just a fact of the matter. It has never been since, I don't know, like, the 80s when they made the Mel Blount rule because he would just absolutely eviscerate receivers as soon as they stepped off the line. They couldn't even get into their routes because he would absolutely mug them. So they made a rule like, hey, you know, we gotta not let them tackle receivers so we have some semblance of entertainment in this game. After all, it is a TV show. Let's remember that. So it's never been since that, 1980, right? You have never been able to hold a receiver to impede his separation and slingshot yourself back into position to cover him. That has never been and will never be not holding. It never will be, never has been. Right, go look frame by frame. Juju is going to break inside, and then he is going to plant his foot, spin, and go to break outside. I don't care if it's behind the line of scrimmage. It does not matter. He's then going to break outside. Here's why it's important, right? So not only all game have the Chiefs been burning him on that route, that's the point of separation. It's not like he was just running a go and there was some contact both ways, right? That is the point of separation, right? Officials are looking at the top of routes. That is the top of that route, right? That's like doing a curl route. You know how like on OPI, if at the top of a route you see a receiver extend their arm, it's PI because that's where the contact matters. So at the top of the route, it has never been and will never be okay to physically impede somebody's progress, thus slingshotting yourself by holding back to a closer point to then defend the football. It's never been okay. It never will be okay. Like, I'm very confused where this notion that like, oh, it was a little tug. Okay, it's never been okay. You can't do it. I'm sorry. It is what it is. Go listen to Sirianni. Go listen to Bradbury himself. Go listen to Jalen Hurts. Nobody's making excuses except for sorry-ass Philadelphia fans. That's on you. That's on you. Wake up. Here's an idea. Maybe make a stop in the second half. Maybe don't let a 60-some-yard punt return. Maybe don't go to switch hands, drop the ball, and let it go for 60 yards the other way. Well, like, there's like plenty of things you could have done for that not to be a problem. Yet it was a problem, and that's who you're going to blame. And we're all so shocked that Philly fans are sorry as hell. All right, that's just the fact of the matter. I'm sorry to let your sky come crashing down on you as if Sunday didn't do it bad enough to you, but that's just the reality of it. I don't know what to tell you. Lost to a better quarterback, better coach, probably a better offensive line at least that day. It is what it is. But to sit there and blame an official, he didn't make a stop in the second half. You had two guys in the red zone get open by 10-plus yards. In the red zone, that doesn't happen. That's not a real thing. All right, in the NFL, that's just not a thing. So, I mean, we can sit here and blame people, but at the end of the day, it's their fault.
Yeah, and I think this is like one of the first times where you see, like, evidently, people are coming out, like the guy who committed the penalty. Right. Most of the time, when they're going to come out and say, no, yeah, that was a penalty, why are you still arguing it? It was so blatantly obvious.
It was also right after the game. It's like he like took his time, digested it, sat back for a week, went radio silent. Right after the game.
And people are pissed about the timing of that penalty, right? They're oh, well, why did they call that one? Well, what if they didn't call that one? What's the timing of that non-call, right? Because then the game could be completely different. They called a penalty. The penalty occurred. They called it. That's their job as NFL officials. They did their job.
I agree. I do feel a little bit for like Philly fans. You know, that's a sucky way to end the game. And even me, I wanted the Chiefs to win, clearly, for some monetary reasons, but also, you know, to prove myself right and again to dump on Philly. But so.
Okay, take a second. But
anyway, but no, for real though, I would have preferred it end in a better way. I think that was an all-time Super Bowl that kind of had a little bit of a lackluster ending to it. Like, I would have liked to see whether they complete that pass, they go on and score, and they have X amount of time, or whether they bleed the clock out, but they win on, like, not their own terms, but quote-unquote the right way.
But they go down score, maybe, and they leave 30 seconds for Mahomes.
So I'm saying, like, say that doesn't get called, but he just doesn't hold him. He gets out of the break. It's a completion, first down.
Yeah.
Maybe the Chiefs score. Do they leave enough time on the clock for the Eagles? Do they not? Do they end up kicking a field goal anyway? How much time does that leave the Eagles? Or even if it's a no call, it's still a holding, it's an incomplete pass, they kick the field goal, there's about 90 seconds for Hurts. First of all, are they able to drive? If they do drive, do they leave too much time for Mahomes? Like, I would have rather have seen a variety of those options, yeah. Any of those options, as opposed to this one. But at the end of the day, like, the outcome I was hoping for still came to fruition. I would have just, I'm with a lot of the fans. I would have preferred it happen in a different way.
Yeah, but yeah. It's a penalty at the very
end. Yeah, but nonetheless, it wasn't the wrong call. It was just an unfortunate situation.
Yeah, well, we were right on the winner of that Super Bowl. So let's get into hits and misses where we go over where we were right and wrong. Here we go.
So let's actually start there with hit number one here. Not only did I call the winner, I called it down to the point.
To the MVP.
Down to the MVP. So I had the Chiefs by three. I had Mahomes being the Super Bowl MVP. Now, it was higher scoring than I thought. I said 27-24. Ended up being 38-35. But I also said it's going to be Chiefs with like a last-minute field goal.
Yep.
And they are going to win by three. Now, like, I might have the script, but it's fine. It's fine.
Send it over to the to the email.
Yeah. And also, did you see Nate Burleson? He used to be a former wide receiver. I want to say for the Lions stuff. Had a decent NFL career, but better than I'll ever have. But anyway, I think he's on like NFL Network or something like that. He was on one of the pregame shows, and he came out, guessed the final score correctly, 38-35. And guessed Andy Reid would have his best coaching game as a coach, which I would say he did. I thought that was, given the circumstances, given the stage, given that his quarterback's on one leg, I would say that's probably the best coaching performance I've ever seen from him. And then he also predicted Mahomes Super Bowl MVP.
Yeah,
that's crazy. That's crazy. Insane. Now, I'm not quite that good, but I'm damn close. I'm just throwing it out there.
My MVP pick was Travis Kelce. That almost
let him in receiving.
It was he was second in MVP voting, really? Apparently for Super Bowl MVP.
See, I'm not gonna lie. I probably, even though he lost, I would have went Hurts for second.
Really?
Because I don't even think that game is even. That game's not even close if Hurts doesn't have the game he has.
Right, but
they averaged like 2 yards a carry without him rushing.
Playing devil's advocate, he also gave them a free scoop and score. So.
Yeah. But I mean, like, he had 4 total touchdowns.
Yeah.
If that cancels out, because it basically cancels out one for one, because on the same exact play, it went down and scored. So he has 3 total. Okay. I mean, that's doable, right? I mean, that's still really impressive. And like I said, that game isn't even a game without Hurts. But whatever. Nonetheless, Kelce did have a good game. I just thought he disappeared a little bit in the second half. That's all. Anyway. All right, miss number one here. We didn't have Jalen Hurts. As I sit here and I give him his flowers, we didn't have him as a top 10 player going into the Super Bowl.
That was a miss, yeah.
Right? Do we have him?
No, he was 11. He we had him at 11.
Okay.
Yeah.
I don't know if he was like not. Okay. So anyway, we had him at like 11. I just thought the bad shoulder would hamper him. Like what we saw in the Hail Mary, that's what I thought we would kind of see the entire game.
Yeah.
Not a lot of velocity, not a lot of touch. Accuracy would be a little bit off.
He is precise,
would
though.
Would probably be a little bit more hesitant to run, kind of leading with that shoulder, so his right shoulder running to the left I thought would be a little bit tough. He hasn't been able to throw right a bunch like in the NFC Championship game. No, No. He threw the ball unbelievable. I thought it was probably, given the circumstances, his best game as a pro, even with the fumble. Could you imagine if he didn't fumble? Because they probably win. He's probably the MVP. And he has probably four. Who knows what they go down and score? Maybe he has five total touchdowns.
Yeah, I mean,
I'm just saying, like, that's probably his best game as a pro, given the circumstances, and he still had room for improvement. That's pretty impressive, actually.
He was he exceeded expectations this year. I will say that we were kind of wrong on Jalen Hurts all year.
Yeah,
stamped it off with this final being wrong on him.
Yeah,
and you know, turn around, take the good old the predictions into next season for him.
To be fair, though, we pivoted like week three. We're like, oh no, like that looks different. Like he looks significantly better. He
took really big steps this year.
Right. So it's not. I mean, we weren't. And that's the thing. If you're wrong or you miss, like you got to move. You got to move off it. You know.
Yeah.
You got to kind of correct yourself quickly. No sense in dwelling on it, which we did. So that's good. All right, hit number two here. I said we talked about this. Derek Carr's a really solid quarterback. We're higher on Derek Carr than a lot of people are. But I did say you can't be giving up like your number one receiver and a pick just to trade for him, like, and then pay him with his $40 million that he's going to be guaranteed this year. That's just not going to work. He can't carry a depleted roster, but he got released. That's probably the best thing for him. I mean, reality, it probably is. So he doesn't have to go to a depleted team. They can just sign him. They don't have to give up a whole lot. They can renegotiate the contract so you can sign other players.
Get pieces around him.
That's the best thing for him, and that's what I said would be the best route, because I just don't think it'd be smart for New Orleans to go give up a second and a starter in the secondary or something, whatever they were going to give up, just to get Derek Carr, and then they're going to have to pay him $40 million, so you're going to have to cut somebody else. Like, it's not a good situation.
Well, now for Derek Carr, they're saying that he has shut down all the rumors of him going to New Orleans. So now they're looking at, like, the Jets, the Falcons was one of them that they threw out there.
Carolina's still in the
Carolina running. And Indianapolis was I think the fourth or fifth landing spot for him.
So if he goes anywhere in the NFC South, wherever he goes, is that not the division winner, right?
Oh, if it's the NFC South, yeah.
And
I mean,
the Falcons, I'd probably hesitate on. I like their coach. Don't love
the brakes a little bit on Carolina.
Oh, I think Carolina. Oh, no. See, I'm the opposite. I think Carolina instantly is a 10-win team with them. They have a real defense. They have a real pass rush. I'm not saying DJ Moore's a 1A, but he's a good, like, 1B, like a second-tier number one receiver.
Yeah, well, him being released now helps this situation a ton.
Yeah, right. And they've been able to run the football a little bit, even without McCaffrey. So, I don't know. I don't think it's that bad of a situation. All right, miss number two here. I kind of thought Brian Flores was the guy for Arizona. I said he'll come in, he'll be a really strong, disciplined guy, kind of get some of their stuff, like, straightened out, like Kyler, you know, not being in the facility enough, all that, right? I thought he would have been a good, like, kind of stern figure to kind of right the ship.
You need that.
But instead, they go with Jonathan Gannon and the defensive coordinator of the Eagles. I mean, he got absolutely undressed in the Super Bowl, so I don't get it. I don't get that hire at all. I think Arizona's a mess. I also find their team and their franchise highly unlikable.
Mm-hmm.
And I say this about Aaron, like, every night, like Aaron outside of football, like him on the like the Joe Rogan, I found that awesome to watch. Aaron with football, I find not likable at all. I don't find Arizona likable, watchable. I don't want to root for them. I don't care about them, to be honest with you.
I agree.
Hit number three here. I figured Shane Steichen was going to go to the Colts. That was kind of an obvious one with the Sirianni connection, the Frank Reich connection. It kind of all adds up. These two organizations have been doing business for a while, so I would imagine he, you know, was the front runner for a while. I said that on the show, and I think he did a really nice job this year, even last year with Hurts' development. I like the hire. Kind of pretty easy to see that one coming. I think he'll do well.
Oh, 100%. I'm excited to see, or interested to see how Philadelphia then comes out of this and what Jalen Hurts looks like next year.
Two new coordinators. But, I mean, let's be real here. That's a struggle. That's gonna be a lot on Sirianni.
I mean, look at what we saw with Buffalo. Josh Allen is not the same guy so far without Brian Daboll. And we can safely say that.
And we can also safely say that he is a, maybe not significantly, but a much better talent than Jalen Hurts.
Yes.
Like a much better
And you can just see a step down there.
Yeah.
So it's going to be interesting for this next year.
All right, Mr. Number Three here. Hey, look, I've been saying it a bunch that I would keep Mike Sullivan if I was the Penguins, but I don't know. I see him going on a road trip and get...
God, they're getting trounced every time they leave Pittsburgh.
Waxed by the Ducks, the Kings. I mean, it's laughable. I mean, they're borderline unwatchable. If it wasn't for Crosby being somehow the enforcer over the last like three or four games, where he's like he's the one sticking up for everybody, if it wasn't for that, then I probably would not watch the team much at all.
He has turned into like Derek England from like 2000.
Yeah, he's like mixing it up. He's like kind of getting into it a little bit. He's getting into the refs, but either way, it's not a good situation in Pittsburgh right now, but they're still in the playoff race, still in the playoff hunt. I think they might even be in a playoff spot right now.
They're,
so
the last wild card spot right now is
they're clinging on, but I don't know. We'll keep monitoring that situation. But no, that's all we got for the first segment here. Coming out in the second segment, we will have the re-ranking of the top 10 players, finally giving Jalen Hurts his official flowers, top 10 players from the Super Bowl, so don't go anywhere. All right, it's the issue. It's second segment on a beautiful post-Super Bowl Thursday.
Yeah.
I'm happy. My hat's happy.
It feels good.
Free hat, by the way. So, you know, went to support a local small business, a little local bar in the area. Not from Kansas City at all. Wasn't near Kansas City even a little bit.
Never known you to be a KC fan.
But, hey, they said, write your name on this piece of paper, fold it up, put it in a bucket. I wrote my name on a piece of paper, folded up, put it in a bucket. First name called, got my pick of the litter at a table of like merchandise. They had some Eagle stuff, like both, you know, both teams merch. They had like sweatshirts, some gloves.
Yeah,
this was probably the best bang for your buck. It's a 47 brand. That's pretty good stuff.
Yeah,
pretty good stuff.
So, would you consider yourself lucky? I never get picked for stuff like that.
I would, and it's like the most random things that I find luck in, right? So like, I don't know. As soon as I saw the paper, I was like, oh, that's my name. Like, it's just one of those things where I just had a feeling. I just knew it deep down. I'm getting picked. To be fair, it was pretty dead in the bar. So there's only like probably 20 names in there. And there was like eight. You're pulling like eight names.
Well, I mean, that does improve the probability a little bit.
But either way, so to start off here, we're going to re-rank the top 10 players in the Super Bowl, right? So for example, we had Hurts at 11. Right? I didn't think with his shoulder injury, he wasn't playing well going into the Super Bowl. I didn't think he was a top 10 player. I thought he was more of a complimentary player. Nope. Wrong. Right? So you're going to see kind of where our thoughts are, you know, where people lie. So without further ado.
Yeah, let's go.
Let's go for it. Okay, we'll start at number 10 here. Let's go with Travis Kelce. Now, I know you second in MVP voting, but he did disappear a little bit in the second half, right? He had, like, I think, four first-half catches. Only two, I think, in the second half, something like that. He did lead the Chiefs in receiving, so he definitely deserves to be on this list. He had a touchdown, so he was good. I thought it was interesting, though, a player a little higher on this list, and you'll see where he ends up and who it is, was actually more of a third-down target because Kelce's normally that big third-down target.
Yeah.
Somebody else was for the Chiefs, so I think that's also why he wasn't quite as high on the list. But he did play well.
Played a great game.
Thought he could have been better down the stretch, but either way, they get the win. He sits at 10.
Look, when you can lead in receiving in a Super Bowl, I mean, come on.
Yeah, not all receivers, but yeah, for a team, yeah, for the winning team, yeah, especially.
Winning team. Right. He very productive in the first half. Really got the Chiefs' momentum going to get started. So Travis Kelce at 10, he's got to make the list at least, you know.
Right, let's go number 9 here. I think Nick Bolton. Now, people might think Nick Bolton is at 9 is a little low considering he had a touchdown. Some people might also think it's high. For the people that think it's a little bit high to rank Nick Bolton in the top 10, look, not only did he scoop and score that, because that's not, I mean, it's a big play, so it's memorable. It's not like that was like that incredible play. I mean, pick up a ball and run. You know what I mean?
Yeah, it's not like
it's not like he like made a one-handed catch, leaped over three people,
and then somehow and then broke scored. Like 6-7 tackles on the way in.
But what's interesting though is the reason that Hurts went to switch the ball to his right hand is because Bolton was coming. I think it was like what I don't know the C gap to make the tackle. Right, Hurts here goes to switch to his right arm to get outside. That's when he lost control. Bolton was right there, so Bolton kind of pressured him into that fumble. So I think that's more significant than people think. So he's at number 9. Number 8 here, this is the person I was talking about. Juju Smith-Schuster is at 8. So I think he was a critical piece, especially on third downs, and really keeping them ahead of the sticks. He didn't do anything crazy, but it was just consistently 7, 8, 9 yards, keeping them on schedule, ahead of the sticks, third down conversions, a really nice safety valve for Mahomes, which is kind of the receiver he is. He's a bigger slot guy. So he's going to be a bit of a mismatch on like a nickel corner that's going to cover him in the slot, like a Mike Hilton.
Right,
he's be a mismatch on him.
Big mismatch there.
But he's also got really nice route running skills, which makes him a bit of a mismatch also for like a linebacker. So he's a sneaky little guy there in the slot. So Juju at 8 feels about right.
And he's somebody that wasn't like expected to make a big splash in the Super Bowl.
Yeah.
And I think that also points back to Andy Reid and his ability to just scheme everything open. Being able to get Juju in those matchups that he likes, I think just says a lot, also, especially against a defense like that.
I'm not saying that like, oh, Juju deserves like, you know, a ton of flowers for this, but like, he ran the route that caused the holding. You know what I mean? Like, he planted his foot. He sold inside enough to where a really, really solid NFL corner in James Bradbury felt he had to hold in order to cover that route. That's a good route to me. Like, that's – and I know it's not, you know, oh, big 80-yard touchdown, but it's the little things like that. That's important. That's a big spot.
Absolutely.
All right, number seven here, Kadarius Toney. I thought the sole most impactful play that, you know – honestly, maybe even over the penalty probably, was that punt return. Oh. I thought that was the most impactful play in the Super Bowl. There's stuff that you can't teach. There's a picture where there's like nine guys around Kadarius Toney and maybe like two blockers, and they're like, yeah, Kadarius Toney ended up getting out of this and like going for 60 more yards. Like, it's just crazy. It's stuff you can't really teach, and he also had a touchdown receiving. Schemed by Andy Reid, but nonetheless, still a touchdown receiving. So I thought those two massive plays from Kadarius Toney.
It was awesome. Are you kidding me? Set Mahomes up and give him the ball at the five.
Yeah, the that's first huge. Set of downs. That's huge.
Come on. Like,
that's huge. All right, number six here, A.J. Brown. I thought, you know, now
he played his ass off.
Yeah, I thought that deep route, that adjustment, people were saying, oh, Hurts with a nice ball. I thought that ball was a really, really bad throw from Jalen Hurts. I thought that was his worst throw. It was underthrown. It was way too far out towards the numbers. I thought it was one of the worst throws of the night, and it ended up looking like one of the best throws because A.J. Brown is that guy. So I thought that was insane, and he was a big reason why they were in that football game. So A.J. Brown at six.
Yep.
But Devonta Smith is slightly higher at number five, and I know we're only ranking really the Super Bowl, but I think you got to look holistically here. He accounted for 54% of the receptions throughout the playoff from Eagles receivers. So he really, really, I don't want to say put the team on his back, but put the receiving core on his back to an extent here in the playoffs. Yeah. He's been spectacular. He led all Eagles receivers in yards. He had seven catches for 100 yards.
In that first half, he was playing insane out of his mind.
He's a really, really talented football player. There's a reason he won the Heisman as a wide receiver, which is pretty rare in today's game.
Never
so
see that.
Yeah, he deserves a lot of credit. He's at number five. Let's do three and four together here because they're basically interchangeable. Number four here we have is Joe Tooney, and three is Creed Humphrey, the center and guard combo for the Chiefs. The reason I put Creed slightly higher is he's a center, so generally they're calling out audibles, doing run checks, like all that stuff, communicating within the line. So I think it's slightly more valuable as a center. That's why I have him higher. But you could argue me into either. I think holding that front to zero sacks and being able to produce the holes running the football that they did against that team, and everybody told him all week, oh, this pass rush, this defense, that didn't matter. No sacks. It was able to run the shit out of the football. That was a really, really nice game plan and a really nice execution, especially from guard, center, guard for the Chiefs.
100% agree.
And people kind of scoffed, and we had them both pretty high going into the game too. And I said, well,
they were pivotal.
They're absolutely massive.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah, so Creed Humphrey at three, Joe Tooney at four.
Both of the offensive lines played great.
Yeah. I mean,
one sack all game.
Yeah. You'll notice that like Lane Johnson and Jace Kelce aren't on here because, I'll be honest with you, they didn't run – like the Eagles did not run the football as well as they needed to.
Yeah.
Because if they were able to, they would have held on to that lead, point blank.
The run blocking was shaky for Philadelphia, but like pass rush-wise
– pass rush was a clinic.
You have Chris Jones, who was the sack leader this year, and then you have the sack leading team – and there was one sack recorded in the entire game.
It's insane. I know. All right, number two here, Jalen Hurts. I thought that was one of the best performances I've ever seen in a loss.
Yeah.
In Super Bowl history, right? So four total touchdowns, three on the ground, one through the air. Now, he did have the fumble. So, in my mind, it just negates just because it went back literally on the same play. Mm-hmm. Call it three total touchdowns. The quality of throws from somebody who's not known as a pure passer was what impressed me.
He proved himself.
If there was any doubt if you were going to sign him or should you sign him or whatever, I think you could kind of put that to bed now. In the biggest stage, he had the best game of his career. And like I said, the fact there was still room for improvement is a credit to him and his work ethic and what I know he's going to be able to do, which is improve on that.
The thing that stuck out to me was his toughness, right?
Yeah,
when you can 100%. Play on an injured shoulder like that.
Throwing shoulder, that's ridiculous.
And then he goes out and he still takes the brunt of every hit because if you didn't watch the game, he ran the ball about 150 times.
He was moving.
Being able to just put the team on your back like that when you are that much in pain.
Led them in rushing.
You saw it. We talked about it earlier. You could see the amount of pain he was in when he threw that Hail Mary.
It was an awful throw because he could not pick his arm up at that point of the game.
I mean, both of the quarterbacks in this game were extremely tough, but Jalen Hurts, I think, is just a different level.
All right, number one, Patrick Mahomes, as if there was any doubt, the Super Bowl MVP. We will begin the third segment with a little bit of a discussion on Patrick Mahomes, but I think that run on a bum ankle is a top three play in his young career. Given the circumstances against what was a historic pass rush with one leg going into the game and then gets hurt, so he's even more in pain, has less mobility, less strength, right?
So impressive.
To be able to pull off a couple of those scrambles late in that football game, and then not to mention playing a legitimate perfect half, perfect second half, one incompletion, and it was a throwaway.
Yeah.
It's unbelievable. I know he didn't have the yard. He didn't need to have the yard. I know he only had 182 or whatever through the air. He didn't need to. He was super efficient. That's what's crazy about Mahomes is he can beat you in wild fashion, or he can just death by a thousand cuts. Efficiency, accuracy, timing, rhythm. He can do it all. It's really, really impressive. So Mahomes comes in at one.
He really does not rely on one style.
There's a list there in case you missed any. Wildly impressive. So we'll go back through. We got Travis Kelce, Nick Bolton, Juju Smith-Schuster, Kadarius Toney, A.J. Brown, Devontae Smith, Joe Tooney, Creed Humphrey, Jalen Hurts, Patrick Mahomes, 10 through 1. Kind of re-ranking the Super Bowl players here. Do a little, almost like a second edition of hits and misses here. But let's transition into some news. All right, story number one here. Let's start kind of in college football, NFL here. Former Georgia offensive coordinator Todd Monken has now he's been hired by the Ravens for their offensive coordinator opening. Look, I mean, he's been really successful at Georgia. I'm not X's and O's versed enough. I mean, I know more than the average person, but I'm not versed enough, and I haven't watched his film in depth enough to know, is it going to fit with Lamar? But the one thing I will say is it's a little bit odd that they've had pretty much all relatively stationary pocket passers. Look, Justin Fields transferred out of there. So there hasn't been a lot of, like, dual threat to the level like Lamar is. So I'm not sure about the fit. Like I said, I'm not X's and O's nitty gritty enough to know, oh, well, he generally likes to run out of 11 personnel more, and, well, the Ravens are more of a 12 personnel team. Whatever. But I just know that he hasn't worked with a guy like Lamar, at least in the recent memory. So I don't know how it works. We'll see how it goes. But, I mean, you can't deny the success he's had at Georgia.
Right. And I think when you look at it from a pure, like, change perspective, when you're looking at college to the NFL, a coordinator position does not have nearly the same failure rate that a head coach does, mainly because you're not dealing head on with the drama. You're not the head guy. You're not taking all of the flack for everything that's going on. You're in more of, I don't want to say administrative, but more like play design. Kind of calling the plays rather than being in the mix with all the players. So
that's interesting.
I think the transition will be smoother than maybe some of the head coaches that we've seen go from college to pro.
Yeah.
But I think he obviously knows his stuff. Georgia has had tons of success, and it will be interesting to see how things play out with, like, a Lamar.
I don't know.
If it's a Lamar.
I don't know how it fits. I don't know. All right, let's go to story number two here. The World Baseball Classic, WBC, rosters and the pools have been released, so it's kind of set up very similar to like a World Cup type thing where you have a pool, you got to make it through pool play, you go to elimination, all that, right? You get a lot of stars. Like, Dominican Republic's loaded. Venezuela is really good. Puerto Rico is loaded. The U.S. is always up there. And then you'll usually get it, one of, like, the Asian countries, whether that be, like, the Chinese Taipei is always really good. China itself is good. Japan's always pretty good. So usually one of them kind of separates from the others, and kind of same with, like, Puerto Rico, Cuba, Dominican. So one of them kind of separate. So I don't know. We'll see how it goes. Obviously pulling for the U.S. You kidding me? The U.S. of A, baby. Honestly, I should have a little flag. So it starts March 7th. You know what? I'll have a flag for that week, for that episode. I'll have a little.
We'll start playing. We'll do that, and we'll play Toby Keith.
Oh, say, can you
speaking of which, though, so can we just digress for a minute? about that national anthem from Chris Stapleton?
Better than the halftime show.
That was the best rendition I have ever heard. Best.
He might be one of the most talented vocalists, regardless of what type of music you like. I might be a little bit biased from country music, but I know people that don't even love country music that love Chris Stapleton.
Yeah.
I mean, just the vocal talent that he has. It's like the Patrick Mahomes of music.
Of country music.
I might coin that phrase. Put it on a shirt.
Put it on a shirt.
Buy it in the shop next month. No, but I mean, I'm serious. That was good. But anyway, like I said, the WBC starts March 7th. I'll be looking forward to that. Love baseball. That's always a really, really nice event. So I can't wait for that. All right, story number three here. Absolutely insane five-round fight. So Alexander Volkanovski moved up in weight class to fight Islam Makhachev, one of the best grapplers.
Right?
Yeah. Not together, but yes, both watched it. So they fought this past Saturday, resulting in a unanimous decision in favor of Islam. Now, I will say I also had Islam. I had him winning 48-47. There was a card, though, that was 49-46. That person should never get to judge a UFC fight again. There is no way that Islam took all, 4 out of 5 rounds. I'm just not buying it.
Yeah, no.
I'm not buying it at all. It was a 48-47. And I thought it should honestly probably be split decision. I figured one of the judges would probably lean Volk. The interesting thing is Volkanovski is a fantastic on-the-feet striker. And he can still ground and pound a little bit, but he's known for his striking. On the flip side, Makhachev is known for his ground and pound, his wrestling, his jiu-jitsu, all that is probably the best in the UFC right now, regardless of size. But Volk's takedown defense and his ground and pound was really impressive. He was able to hold his own on the ground. And on the flip side, Makhachev landed a lot of good strikes on Volk. So, I mean, it was an interesting fight. Very contrasting styles.
Yeah.
But it was a great fight. But, yeah, anyway, Islam won. Probably the best pound-for-pound fighter right now in the UFC.
I think so. Right, he's got to be.
So here's the only pushback that people are going to give is that he's not the most entertaining. So Adesanya is very similar in regards to Izzy is a phenomenal counter striker, right? But he's not going to go insane, wild, offensive, put himself in a vulnerable spot just to knock you out. He is going to stay in the pocket. He's going to stay patient, leg kicks, body shots, and he's going to take his moment when it gets there. And both of them are going to have insane motors. Makhachev, similarly, like, a lot of people don't understand and don't, I don't want to say don't enjoy, but they'd rather watch a stand-up fight more so than, like, a ground-and-pound fight. So a lot of people don't like the aesthetics of a Makhachev, but he's unbelievable.
But once it goes to the ground, it's very technical. And if you're not, like, technically versed in UFC, it's kind of tough to pay attention. I have to say, that was one of the best fights, though.
That was unbelievable.
I remember watching in, like, recent history. I was at a bar. I was in the perfect setting for it, right? You get the big reactions from everybody that's around you.
That's got to be unbelievable.
Especially when you're a couple of Miller Lite. We're not going to... White Huggies deep.
White Huggies.
It was a fantastic time, fantastic fight. The only thing that I wish is that Joe Rogan called every single fight. I understand he only does the North American stuff, but if he was on the call, that would have been better. 10 times better.
And I like Bisping, but he's not...
He's not Joe Rogan.
Yeah.
That's not Joe Rogan.
That's Michael Bisping, right? No.
No, it was...
I'm sorry, not Bisping. Dude. You gotta look it up. The one thing that I did want to say, so Islam... He's super, like you said, technical. When you go to the ground, I'm no master by any means in wrestling, but I've watched, I don't know how many fights. He is probably the best wrestler and the best grappler that I've seen. And what's interesting is, so Bo Nickel, he's a former, four-time national championship from Penn State wrestler. I don't even know if they're in the same weight class. That's how much I don't know about Bo Nickel. But either way, if they are, that would be an interesting fight. Like you said, it was one of the best fights that you remember in recent history. I'm trying to think. So, I mean, you're looking at, like, Ngannou, Cyril Gane was a good one. Tony Ferguson, Michael Chandler, when Michael Chandler front kicked Ferguson right
Michael
in the chin.
Bisping, you were right.
Was it Bisping?
Yeah.
Okay, that's what I thought. I thought it was Bisping. Is he an Aussie?
I don't know. I didn't click on his Wikipedia.
Again? Look him up again. I'm pretty sure that's also why. That was in Australia. Because Volkanovski fights out of Australia. I think he's actually from there, which I thought he was Russian. I don't know. Call me stereotypical, but anytime I hear a ski, I'm just assuming.
American and British.
Makes me an ass, I guess. He's American, British. Okay, so yeah. He's got that little hint of the accent there.
Yeah.
All right, story number four here.
He's 6'1", if you were wondering.
6'1"? Thank God. Yeah, I was going to stay up at night. So, fourth story here. It's interesting. Not a lot of people are talking about it. James Bradbury was wearing dark green gloves in the Super Bowl. And it's noteworthy because obviously the Chiefs were wearing white. And I didn't think much of it until I remembered a story that Belichick, or I guess I think it was Julian Edelman, or one of the players from the Patriot dynasty, told a story that anytime, especially in big games, Belichick would tell the players whatever the color of the jersey is. If it was dark, you're going to wear, for the Patriots, you'd wear navy blue. Mm-hmm. If you're playing against the red team, because Patriots are secondary color red, you'd wear red gloves. Yeah. If you're playing and the opponent's wearing a white jersey, you're going to wear white gloves. Right, you get away with a little bit more around the edges with holding. It's tougher to see. It's a real thing. These athletes are moving really fast. They're colliding. It's tough for the officials to see. They're 10, 15, 20 yards away, moving fast, bodies colliding. It makes sense.
It's one of the little things in the game that you don't really think about.
Is it a factor?
I think it is. I think 100% it is. Think about in a baseball game how important it is. Like, we never played on a lot of stadiums that have like a batter's eye.
Yeah,
like
but
being able to pick up the baseball is like being able to watch penalties is bang bang in the same way.
Yeah.
Even when you're looking at like a play, like that's, you know, if it's going to be reviewed or not.
Yeah,
those things happen so quick.
I agree. So I mean, I think it's like a little bit of an edge that, you know, or I guess the lack thereof, that kind of may have cost them a call there. I don't know. It's interesting. Leave it to Belichick, of course.
Didn't Sean McVay do that recently too?
Maybe. I know McVay talked about how in the Super Bowl against Belichick, he kind of got like out nuanced in like those little areas,
like
that.
Things, yeah.
Maybe Sirianni did as well. I don't know. Either way, I thought it was an interesting point. But guys, don't go anywhere. When we come back, third segment, we're going to talk a little bit about Mahomes, what that win means for his legacy, and then we will also do a little up, down, sideways. Where are NFL teams trending after the season here, going into the draft, free agency, all that? So don't go anywhere.
Let's go. We are back. Third segment on Thursday, February 16th. So far, been a great episode, and we only have more football to talk. So to start this segment, we are going to have a little bit of a rant and then into a discussion on Patrick Mahomes, just how great he has been. How it was a pure spectacle, what we witnessed at the Super Bowl this year. And it is just so on brand with how he plays the game. He is for sure one of the standouts of the league, and we are going to discuss all of that first. And then to finish up the segment, we will have up, down, sideways. I think we got 7 NFL teams. We're going to give you the way that they are currently trending going into the offseason. Now, this is pre-draft. I'm assuming that we're going to do another one of these after the draft. And once we can kind of
after draft, free agency, all that good stuff. Yeah, yeah.
Yeah, once some coaches move around and we get some new staff in some places. So it will be interesting to keep up and follow. So make sure you go to theissuesports.com. Sign up, subscribe wherever you listen. That way you don't miss an episode and you get all of the content that we are putting out here every single week, every single Thursday. And we appreciate you guys listening. So yeah, go head on over to theissuesports.com and follow on all the social medias.
Right. And I know, so I started the episode kind of talking about, you know, the penalty and Philadelphia and how, you know, they can complain if they want, but at the end of the day, like, you got to get a stop in the second half. And I mean, that is the reality of the situation. At the end of the day, it doesn't matter who's on the other sideline. You gotta get a couple stops, at least one in the second half. No stops in the second half is a little bit ridiculous, I would say. But I will admit that it's easier said than done when you're facing a talent like Mahomes, coached by a guy like Andy Reid, with really, really solid weapons. Now we know that the receiving corps isn't all that, but you got Travis Kelce, 2 good backs, and like I said, probably the best coach in football, the best offensive coach, arguably, in the history of the game. So, but here's something that's just crazy about Patrick Mahomes is early in his career, he was more high-flying, big throws across his body, on the run, 50 yards down the field, almost Madden-level stuff where you're playing with like a reckless abandon, but it was just everything was working. He was going all in, everything was coming up royal flush. I mean, he couldn't miss, right? He was a shooter on a hot streak, couldn't miss, right? And what's become so fascinating to me is he has not only pivoted from that, he has gone so far away from that on a game-by-game basis, yet that's still in the bag of tricks if it's needed. What I mean by that is, he used to be, like I said, a little less efficient, a little more high-flying, push the ball downfield. He's become one of the most efficient players in NFL history. I mean, it's turned into recently, it could be death by a thousand cuts. I mean, here's 6 yards here, 7 yards there. There's 11. Oh, third and one. Dip it off to the running back. There's four. Keep the chains moving. Right? He only had 187, 182, something like that, yards in the Super Bowl. Wasn't wildly impressive. It's 6 incompletions. Won the entire second half as a throwaway. Right, so what he's been able to do, pivoting from this high-flying, high-risk player to one of the most efficient, safe, accurate quarterbacks in football is incredible. And the success he's been able to have while doing it. It's not like he took a down year. It was like, we're kind of reworking the offense here. We lost Tyreek, and I'm kind of becoming a little bit of a different player. We're going to rework. We're going to retool. A little bit of a down year. We'll just make the playoffs, maybe get bounced first, second round, whatever, right? No. His worst season as a pro is a Pro Bowl. You know, Pro Bowl, division title. Lost at home in the AFC Championship game in overtime. That's his worst season as a pro. His best season, MVP, Super Bowl MVP, set the record for the most yards in the history of the league in a season, played an entire playoff run on damn near one leg, and looked spectacular doing it. That's his best season. His worst is an AFC Championship overtime loss. Overtime. Right? It's incredible what he's been able to do and maintain this level of success. It's something I know Brady had 3 in his first 5 years. He's also had 3 in his first 14 years, right? I'm not worried about that. The trajectory he is on right now and what he has already done, if he retired tomorrow, I think he'd be the third best quarterback in NFL history. I think you got to put Brady 1. I don't think that's an argument. Before I reveal 2, I think he's better than Peyton. I think the physical ability of Patrick Mahomes is better than Peyton Manning. I know Peyton has the 5 MVPs, but the 2 Super Bowl MVPs and the 2 MVPs for Mahomes, I think, trumps that along with the physical talent. I think he's better than a Big Ben, who also has 2. I don't think it's particularly close. Now, I know Ben had 2 in his first 4 or 5 years, and Mahomes also has that, but Ben never got back. He got back once, lost. He never was able to maintain that success. I mean, who knows if Mahomes is going to, but I have a feeling he'll be back, right? I have a feeling he'll be back. I'm trying to think of other guys that have 2. Like, I think Brett Favre has 1. Aaron has 1. Now, I know it's not all about titles, but I think he's better than both of them. I don't think it's particularly close. I think he's much more amenable. He's a better teammate. I think he's more coachable. So number 2, to me, I would say Joe Montana right now is slightly ahead of him. What he was able to do to lead and captain that dynasty deserves a lot of credit. Now, I don't think Mahomes has to get 4, though, to pass him. I think if Mahomes gets 1 more and another MVP, I think he passes him. I don't think it's particularly close after that.
Yeah.
That's my claim for Patrick Mahomes. That's my little fanboy moment there. I just think he's... Could the league be in better hands? That's one thing I saw, you know, even after the press conferences, right? He's given the flowers to Jalen. Jalen's given them right back. They're both so humble. And Mahomes is just... I'm like, could the league be... could the Super Bowl MVP and the league MVP have gone to a better person and a better player?
No.
Point blank, no. That's the exact right answer. No.
It gets dicey when you start comparing Mahomes to like some of these guys that are thought of as greats and then are greats because he's been here just for so little time.
Right.
When you are comparing Patrick Mahomes to and Aaron Rodgers, I agree. I think Patrick is more talented. I think Patrick, he obviously wins more. He wins bigger games more often than Aaron does.
Couldn't agree more.
But it's just hard because you have the years and years of like legacy of Aaron in Green Bay.
Yeah.
But like, I mean...
So what Aaron has, what, 4 MVPs?
Yeah.
I know that's impressive, but...
It's impressive, but when you look at a pure talent comparison... From that standpoint,
Mahomes is better.
You have to give it to Mahomes.
And I know Aaron throws a beautiful football, but Mahomes is better. And he wins more.
He does. And it's the big pivotal games that I think really stand out.
100%.
It's just, it is actually insane to think about. Because how often can you compare somebody that's been in the league for 5 years to somebody that was in the league for 18, like Ben Roethlisberger? But like at the same time, he has already surpassed Ben. and really anything that Ben has ever done.
Right. And so, right now, a lot of people have something, over him, right, per se. Like, Aaron's got the four MVPs, and Peyton's got five MVPs, and Montana's got four rings. Brady has, what, seven? I think what Mahomes has over anybody is he is the youngest quarterback to have a legitimate, and I would argue concrete, argument for a top five player of all time.
Yeah.
Right now, if he retired today. I think this is the youngest I've ever seen where you can actually definitively say, I think if he retired tomorrow, he's a top five quarterback of all time.
I think so,
too. I think he's a top 10 player of all time, regardless of position, if he retired tomorrow.
Have you seen a quarterback go through as much pain, as much adversity at times as Patrick Mahomes, and still play at the top of his game unfazed?
Like, the only thing that comes to my mind is Philip Rivers playing on a torn ACL, but like you said, top of his game, Philip wasn't on top of his game. It was gutsy. He was still good, but he wasn't that.
With a high ankle sprain, wasn't that. Patrick Mahomes, in the fourth quarter of the Super Bowl, scrambled for a 35-yard gain up the middle on an insane Philadelphia Eagles defense.
Yeah.
If that doesn't say greatest of all time to you, I'm not sure what does. Also, I've seen Patrick Mahomes make throws that I didn't even know were humanly possible to be made at the NFL level. How about the one where he's literally sideways to the ground, no feet on the ground, not even a hand on the ground.
Yeah.
Throwing with nothing attached to the ground. Do you guys know how physics works? That shouldn't be possible. And to throw a dart like he did.
And for it to be dropped in the end zone of the Super Bowl.
It is the things he's able to do are...
He's quite a marvel.
They are game-changing and, I mean, just all-time great moments couldn't in agree football.
More. I couldn't agree more. And that's a perfect way to end that little discussion there. Let's go ahead and actually get into up, down, sideways. For those who might be new, game we kind of go through here, we're going to go through. We have seven NFL teams today. Right now, today, right, we're postseason, and we're kind of heading into the draft. We're looking at, cap space, draft picks, you know, who's returning, who has the possibility to return, the momentum of the team, all that. Up, down, sideways, are they trending up, down, are they kind of a... going sideways, right? Like just average, right? Pretty average. So we'll get into that. We got the seven players. Let's go start with the Pittsburgh Steelers hometown team here. Actually, speaking of Pittsburgh, we're going to start with Pittsburgh. We talked about this a little bit.
Great new name.
I almost forgot until right now. We're from Pittsburgh. Why not embrace it?
Yeah.
So it was your idea. Go ahead and unveil the new named up, down, sideways.
Oh, really? It just started because, frankly, I just write stupid things. And I was coming up with a name to jot down here for the teams that we have in our list. And up, down, sideways, well, what do you usually hear when you go downtown to a Steeler game? So the new name of this segment is up, down, sideways.
Dan.
Dan spelled D-A-H-N.
Up, Dan, sideways.
That might be a shirt.
So we're going Dan Tan to Heinz Field. None of that Acrisure. It's Dan Tan, Heinz Field.
Absolutely.
The Pittsburgh Steelers.
Get yourself a permanent
hard-nosed defense. An ice-cold Iron City.
Get down here. Talk about how Dick LeBeau is the best to ever do it.
All right, we're done. We're done here. So let's start with Pittsburgh. I'm going to go trending up. First of all, rookie quarterback second-year quarterback on his rookie contract. We know historically that that's kind of the way to shape the roster around a quarterback who's not making a ton of money yet.
Yeah.
And let's be real here. Let's be honest about Kenny Pickett. The last five or six games, he played really good football. Turned the football over less, was more productive, started to use his legs in better, in more wise ways. Like, wasn't just running like crazy, but when he needed to, he was getting outside the pocket, he was moving good. So we got to be honest about Pittsburgh. They are an ascending team. They have cap space. They have basically two first round picks. They have the the 17th right now, and then they also have
the 34th.
Well, no, 32nd. But it's technically a second round pick because Miami vacated their first round pick. So we got a second round pick from the Bears. Their second round pick. Well, they're leading off, right? They're number one overall. So their second round pick would have been 33. But since Miami vacated, they got their pick vacated. So there's only 31 first-round picks. So we get the 32nd pick, which is basically a first-round pick.
Yeah, that's huge.
So, I mean, that's a trending up team.
That 100% is. And
draft capital, cap space.
You know, you saw
young quarterback on the rise.
You saw what you needed to with Kenny this year.
100%.
That was the big thing. He didn't have to look like an MVP. Yeah. He didn't have to win you an AFC championship game. He didn't have to take you to the playoffs. All you had to do was to make sure you didn't miss on Kenny last year.
Yeah, I agree.
And we saw that. Steelers going up makes sense.
All right, so let's go with the Buffalo Bills. So I'm going to go down here. I'm actually looking up the cap space right now because I totally forgot to look that up.
Look, it's shaky because we've now seen Josh Allen take a step back without Brian Daboll, and it's interesting. Like, you can't...
So, I mean, right now the Bills are $20 million over the cap going into this year.
Yeah, you can't bank on that.
So no cap space. Draft capital is fine, but they're so good that they're not going to be drafting in the top 10-15 for the next, what? Until Josh Allen
is done.
Is done, yeah. Seriously. So your drafts are going to be okay, but you really got to hit on late-round picks, and you don't have any cap space. And let's be real about this. Without Brian Daboll, without the really, really good coordinator that he was, Josh Allen regressed. Let's call it what it is. Yeah. There's no run game. I don't like the offensive line. I think outside of Stephon Diggs, there's not a go-to number two target.
It didn't look creative at all. Like, the one thing that like stood out with Buffalo, like, 2 years ago was how creative that offense was and how they could build a scheme around Josh Allen. Did not see much of that this year. How are you going to, like, bank on that, hang your head on that organization trending up as a whole?
It's just on Josh Allen's shoulders, and without Daboll, he's regressed. I can't count on that.
100%. Bills are going down.
Let's go with Dallas. I think Dallas is a clear going down
another
as well.
Descending team.
Yeah. Another descending team. So Dak's contract starts to kick in. Let's see. With the cap, they're $7.5 million over. So, I mean, they're going to have to part ways with somebody. Probably one of their defensive linemen, maybe DeMarcus Lawrence. I don't know. I think he's fantastic, but you might have to. You have to really start exploring, is Zeke the right guy? What's the dead cap hit on him? You got to start looking at things like that. Tony Pollard, I would say
he was a
significantly more productive back. He's more explosive. I think CD's a fine number one, but if he shows out for this year, you're going to have to pay him.
But you got
to
pay Micah soon.
You got to pay Micah soon. You got to pay CD Lamb soon. You got to pay Trayvon Diggs soon. It's really great when you get one draft where they all hit, but it's also tough because now they're all up for a contract at the same time.
You can't keep them all.
It's very, very tough. I would say trending down for sure.
Yeah.
Miami Dolphins. I think Miami sideways feels about right to me. I think if Tua comes back, which all indications are that Tua is coming back, that's a 9-10 win team tops. That's probably getting bounced in the first round if they're lucky enough to get into the playoffs. To be honest, that's kind of is that their ceiling? It feels like their ceiling with him. It does. It does. He looks outclassed against Buffalo and New England, like the really solid defensive teams, or when they play star quarterbacks, the Mahomes, the Lawrence, the Herberts.
It's almost like he's prepared for really easily by other teams.
Yeah, but also, so the reason they're not trending down, though, I will say, is they still have really good offensive talent. I love their coach. And let's be real, Tua is super competent.
Yes.
Like, he's not going to lose you games most of the time. He's going to get the ball accurately on time. I don't have a lot against Tua. I just think in the AFC, he's at best, what, the sixth, seventh best quarterback?
Yeah.
That's tough to win.
Yeah, it is. And like you said, the pieces around Tua, the weapons that he has, the Jalen Waddle, the Tyreek Hill, the Mike Gesicki, those type of guys,
yeah, good backs,
are
yeah.
the ones that are propelling him to look a little bit better than he is. I mean, you put him on a trailer. Yeah, he needs those pieces to like move in the right direction for him to be able to win.
Yeah,
like you toss him on a less talented roster, like go put him in a Jacksonville. He doesn't have the success that a Trevor Lawrence has.
100%.
That's why I think Trevor Lawrence is a better quarterback.
Oh, significantly.
Yeah.
Yeah, no,
but
I agree.
People are making the argument that he's not.
No, that's ridiculous. All right, San Francisco. I think they're going sideways. First of all, I don't know what their quarterback situation is. And I get that Brock played well. Let's pump the brakes a little bit. He's a seventh-round pick for a reason. We saw for sure limitations with his arm and his ability to push the ball downfield consistently. And let's be real. A UCL injury is no joke. Right, that is no joke. That is a 18-month rehab for a baseball player if they get Tommy John. And you're telling me he's going to be back and ready for the season? I'm not buying it. I think he misses the first half of the season. Do I trust Trey Lance? Not really. He's played about, 10 football games in the last 4 years? I don't trust that.
No, not at all.
And let's be real here. Trent Williams is aging. George Kittle's aging. Christian McCaffrey's aging. Now, granted, they still have talent. They're not trending down. They're not trending down because they still have great talent, a fantastic offensive coach.
And they're going to have one of the best rosters this next year, too.
Yeah, and let's be real. Do we expect Seattle to be that good again? Probably not. I think they're about the same level, if not a little bit worse. So, and I don't think Arizona poses much of a threat. Who knows if Stafford comes back healthy? I mean, let's be real.
Or that, if Stafford even goes back to the Rams, because now there's talk of him going to the Jets.
That division's not quite as good as we thought it was going into this past season. So I think sideways feels about right. I don't think, let's be real, they had, what, 12 wins? They ripped off like 12 in a row.
Yeah.
So at a certain point, it's like, trending up would mean I think you're going to win more games. You look better next year than you did this year. That's a high bar.
Mm-hmm.
So I think they're sideways. They're going to be about to that level again.
Right.
Minnesota, I think down. I don't think they're going to go 11-1 in one score possessions again. Or 11, I'm sorry, 11-0 in one possession games. That's an anomaly, right? The year before, 2021, they were like 3-8.
It
ebbs and flows. So they're not going to be 11-0 in those close games again. Let's be real, Kirk shrinks a lot. And their defense is really bad. Now, I know you get Flores, which is a great get, but Kirk's not getting any younger. Justin Jefferson, you're going to have to pay him soon. So what's that look like? The offensive line's not great. Dalvin Cook stayed healthy this year, but is that really...
He didn't put up numbers.
Not numbers, and he did miss a couple games, and I don't know. I just think... I think they take a step down, and I think Green Bay is going to get a little bit better. They're probably going to win about 10 games, compete for the division. So I think Minnesota's a 10-11 win team, which is down from their 13. I don't think they plummet to the depths, but I don't think they're going to be another 13-14 win team again.
Damn, they got lucky. They got lucky that they had that 11-0 record in those close games. That's a lot of luck. Yeah, they played well at points, but they were so shaky the whole time.
Plus, we expect Detroit to be a little better, too. So.
Oh, yeah, I think so.
Let's go with Cincinnati. I think sideways. I think a very similar reason for San Francisco is they set the bar pretty high. I mean, their AFC championship game almost every year now is kind of the expectation.
Mm-hmm.
So I don't think up would be, yep, I see them as the favorite in the AFC. I don't think that's true today. I mean, I'm not sure. I haven't looked ahead far enough. We haven't been through free agency, the draft yet, so we'll get there. But to say up would be like, oh, they're far and away the contender or the favorite for the AFC. I don't think that's true.
Yeah, and since when has Cincy really started hot, like blazing out of the gates?
They don't often.
They lost to Pittsburgh this year in week one. They started a little bit shaky until
2-3 or something like
that? Yeah, until week six, week seven, it didn't even look like they had a semblance of a playoff run that they could muster up.
No, I agree. And I don't think they're also going down because at the end of the day, you have Burrow, Chase.
Yeah.
Who knows, but we'll see with Mixon. Mixon's talented. We'll give him that. Not the best person, but talented. Offensive line will probably get better. Defense, I think sideways feels about right for Cincinnati. But that's everything we got. Make sure you check out the store. The orders are shipping here. Can't wait. So if you bought stuff, pay attention to your mail. Really appreciate you guys stopping by. Go check out the social medias. They're all linked to all that stuff. I don't know. That's all him.
Yeah. All the links are on the website. The website link can be found in the description of the episode or whatever video you are watching / listening to. So we appreciate it, guys.
Yeah.
We will be back next week. Got a lot of cool stuff to start unveiling here in the NFL offseason. So make sure you stick around. Subscribe to that newsletter. Okay. Go to theissuesports.com. It is right there, right on the homepage. Go check it out, guys. But that is all we have for today, and that was The Issue.